welcome to Portage County Matters. I'm Patty Dreier, Portage County Executive. Glad to have you with us today. We're going to talk about one of my favorite subjects. That would be water. This happens to be a show about water quality today, about the countywide water quality study that we're conducting in 2017. It's really exciting because it'll give us a snapshot in time of water quality across our whole county. And with me today, of course, it has to be. I don't even have to say your name ahead of time, and they're filling in the blank, Jen. Jen McNelly, our Water Resource Specialist with Portage County. Welcome.
Thank you, Patty. Thanks for having me today.
Now, your office is located in the Planning and Zoning Department, and I know that you are a very famous person out there in the community these days, for you're the one that's really been helping staffing the groundwater management plan for our county.
Yeah, I'm there. I'm working on the groundwater management plan, answering a lot of questions that people might have about wells and water quality around the county. So,
yeah, wonderful. So, one of the coolest things that's happened in a long time, if you ask people like me, it's the county budget, 2017 county budget. We put $25,000 in that budget for a project, the project that we're going to talk about today. It's a countywide water quality study, and there's a couple of counties that have done this kind of thing before. Let's talk a little about that, and then what are we going to study and why we're going to do it.
Sure. So this is new for Portage County. This is the first time it's ever been done. Currently, Chippewa County did a similar project. Chippewa County had done sampling a few years back, about 10 years ago, and this is a resample for them, a follow-up. So what we're doing is we're looking at water quality across the entire county and trying to get an idea, like you said, a snapshot in time of water quality across the entire Portage County. So we've never done this in Portage County. We have a lot of water quality information.
That's right.
We have a lab here, so it makes it pretty easy for people to take and sample their water. But what happens is we get kind of hot spots of information. So where people have concerns or have tested positive before, they're more likely to resubmit a sample for water quality sampling. So we actually have parts of the county that have never had a water quality sample done before, and we have no information for them.
Wow.
Which kind of leaves us wondering, you know, what's happening in those areas. The other thing is, so when we have these samples, we don't get them all at the same time.
That's right.
They're done at different times. Water quality changes. It can change varying on the season, on the amount of precipitation that we have, all sorts of different things. So for us to get a uniform look at the same time, it's really a good comparison. And it sets up a type of program that we can replicate in the future. So then we can really start looking at possible trends over time, which is something that we don't have a whole lot of ability to do right now.
Without a study like this.
Right, without a study like this.
So, fabulous. Let's talk about what kind of quality indicators we're looking at in this particular study and why.
Sure. So, some of the parameters that we're going to be looking at, we're going to be looking at nitrate, nitrogen. We're going to be looking at alkalinity, pH, chloride, corrosivity. I'm trying to think of the other ones. Those are kind of the big ones. There's a number of different factors. If somebody were to wonder what we were looking for, what we're going to be testing for is the homeowner's package minus bacteria through the analysis lab at UWSP.
And there may be some people asking quickly, why not? Why not go ahead and test for bacteria as well?
Well, that's a good question. So there's a couple of different reasons why we didn't really want to do that. When a homeowner tests for bacteria, there's really two types of bacteria that we test for. There's a total chloroform and an E. coli. A total chloroform is an indicator of bacteria in a person's well or water, but it's not a health risk for them. It's just bacteria coming from someplace. The E. coli is what most people think of when they think of bad bacteria in their water. That is an indication of some sort of fecal matter, either human or animal, that's entered your wastewater. In Portage County, when we have a bacteria sample that tests positive, a lot of times it isn't for E. coli, it's for total chloroform. And because we're looking at general water quality, total chloroform often isn't an indicator of general water quality issues, it's more of a well-specific issue. So something's amiss with the well most often. It's a well cap, it wasn't constructed properly, things like that. So that's one reason why it just isn't a great indicator for us of overall water quality. The second reason why is that it's hard to test for bacteria. It's a very finicky test. There's a lot of contamination risk when you take a test. So in a project of this scale, it can be really hard to get accurate samples for that.
So I know that lots of folks are listening on the radio and they can't see this on television, but for those watching on YouTube or on TV, on cable access television, we have a map here of Portage County, and Jen's going to walk us through a little bit about what our approach for this scientific study is all about, how it works, and then how come we're having the show, like, you know, whose wells are we going to test, how is it going to work, and what happens if they participate or not.
So. Sure.
Let's talk about the grid system.
So when we set up the project and we initially decided to do this project, what we really wanted to make sure is that we could replicate it and that it was going to be replicable going into the future, something that we could do again and get results where we can compare over time. So we felt the best way to do that was to follow procedures that have been laid out, very similar to what DATCAP does when they do a large water quality sampling.
DATCAP is Department of Ag, Trade, and Consumer Protection,
yes,
for anybody who doesn't know the acronym.
Absolutely. And so what we did was we set up a grid system over the entire county. Each square is 2 miles by 2 miles and covers a 4-square-mile area. And so this grid gave us an opportunity to look at all of the wells within that grid square. And what we did was we randomly selected a well within each of these 4-square-mile areas. Now, we have 3 on the map that actually don't have any wells. These 2 are probably the most prominent, and those are the Mead Wildlife Area. And if you're pretty familiar with that area, there's not a whole lot out there. So no wells. So we won't be getting any samples from those areas. But what we did then, for each of these areas where there are wells, we actually put even a smaller grid over this grid, so that we could try and give every well in this 4-square-mile an equal chance of being sampled. If we just randomly chose a well, it could be skewed by these really dense areas where there's a lot of wells. And so we wanted to give everybody a fair chance at having their well selected. So we randomly selected one of those smaller squares and then went to a random selection of a well within the small square that
Excellent.
Was selected.
Okay, I'm following
so,
you.
Yeah. So that covers the entire county. And you might be asking yourself, well,
how many samples?
Right, exactly. So 269 samples across the entire county, which is a pretty good number.
269.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so now let's talk about the homeowners that are selected in this randomized initial well selection process and how to participate and the fact that the cost is covered.
Yeah.
By the tax dollars that are supporting the water quality study in the county in the first place.
Sure. So Portage County is partnering with the Center for Watershed Science and Education at the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point and the Water and Environmental Analysis Lab there. So we're kind of helping to coordinate things behind the scenes, but they're going to be doing a lot of the boots on the ground logistical work for us just because they have a staff that's able to do that. So what's going to happen is in May, we're going to be sending letters out to the selected homeowners. And the selected wells are the ones that are in blue.
So you can particular map on this, folks can see if you're watching on television.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So we have those selected wells already. So the homeowner will receive a letter in the mail. It'll be on university letter, an envelope that's marked by the university and on university letterhead. And there'll probably be a mark on the outside that says free water sample inside. And they'll get a letter and they'll explain the process and kind of the timeline of how things will unfold if a homeowner wants to participate. Now, included with that letter will also be a postcard because obviously not everybody might want to participate in this program. So owners will have an opportunity to fill out the postcard and say, yes, I want to participate, and they can send it back in, or no, I don't want to participate at this time. And if they choose not to, then what we'll do is we'll go back to our random selection and we'll select a different well in that 4-square-mile area.
Jen, let's go back to one thing that I think is really important before we go ahead again on how the process will work. Why are we testing for nitrates?
Sure.
In water.
So nitrate, nitrogen is probably one of the most well-known water quality issues or contaminants that we have in Portage County. It's the one that people often talk about. Anyone who bring up nitrates, probably the most well-known health risk associated with that is the blue baby syndrome. And so what that is when there's too much nitrogen in the system, an infant isn't able to get enough oxygen and they turn blue. And so that right there was largely the reason that the state health standard was put in place. And the state health standard is 10 milligrams per liter.
Or parts per million.
Or parts per million of nitrate nitrogen. And so since then, more studies have been done about it because it's one of the most widespread contaminants, not only in Wisconsin, but really in most of the US. And so there's some other associated health risks that are starting to come out, links to potential cancers, some neural tube defects for moms who have a exposure to really high levels of nitrate. And then of course it's toxic to aquatic life and eggs and amphibians and stuff. So there's a wide range of impacts of nitrate nitrogen. So that's something that we want to be looking at. You know, we know in Portage County from the samples that have been done, we have about a 19% exceedance rate for nitrates.
That means we have more than the health standard.
Yep, about 19% of water samples that have been submitted to state certified labs exceed the state drinking water standard, which is about twice the state average. So the state average is about 10%. And so that gives us pause and really wants to, you know, is a chance for us to say, okay, we know something's not right here. We need to take a closer look at this.
I think one of the other points that we want to make sure that our listeners are catching on to if they're not following what this means in water in their own lives at this time is that nitrates occur in the natural systems around us, but at a very, very, very low amount, 1 or 2%, something around that range. So if you have more than that, it's a human-caused effect. Mm-hmm. And that's the other point here. Where does it come from in our human-caused effects? Well, it comes from a number of places. It may come from fertilizer that you put on your lawn, around your house. It may come from fertilizer on a farm field or other manure or whatever it is on a farm field. And the bottom line is on the edge of springtime, when we're talking about this study, it's natural, no pun intended, but natural for us to then put out a message. I know I would like everybody to understand that what we're doing to the land, we're also doing to ourselves, right? And if the nitrate isn't all consumed by the plants, say on our lawn, then it'll leach through the soil and contaminate water. And it's not just if you live on a private well that we're talking about some implications for your health or your family, especially families with children. I hope they don't turn down the opportunity for this water test, this free water test, or for people who have immune deficiencies of some sort, because there are some serious implications for health that we have a great opportunity to address here. But we want to make sure that even folks that live in the urban areas that are, say, on city water or village water, understand that we're paying for the chemicals to clean up the nitrate issues in those water systems. So it's coming out of your tax dollars there, too. So the more what we can be more sensitive on the front end of the system, and understanding that if we held back on nitrogen and really gave pause to that, then the more we'll save dollars and health and well-being on the other end of the equation. And I think that's a really important point for everybody to understand.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a whole system and it's all interconnected. So,
okay, so let's go back. We've got these water tests, the homeowner's package minus the bacteria test, which it's about a $40 value that families will be able to get, homeowners will be able to get if they're numbers called, so to speak, on the randomized sampling exercise. They're going to get a letter from UW-Stevens Point at home. On the letter, it's going to have something else with our Portage County logo noted in
it. Absolutely. The letter will have both Portage County and the university's signature on the bottom.
And then there's going to be a postcard.
Yep.
And they return the postcard if they're interested or not in receiving the opportunity for this study.
Right. And then the assistants from the university that'll be working to collect these samples, they'll be in contact. Once they receive a postcard saying, yes, I'm interested in participating, they'll contact the homeowner directly to set up a time when it might work for the homeowner to collect the sample, where the sample should be collected from, whether it's an outside faucet or an inside faucet. It doesn't really matter for the homeowner, but they'll work out all those details between the two of them then.
And if the person turns it down, then you're going to go to the next random sample within that square of the grid of 2 miles by 2 miles quadrant or grid in Portage County.
Yep, exactly. We'll start trying to go to the next closest wells to try and keep it in that general area until we can find somebody that's willing.
Okay, so let's follow it through. So now we have these tests completed. You've now got some data points across the county, and that data has been collected. Let's talk about how homeowners can make, will be getting their results, and also how we keep the data anonymous to the address, if you would, in the bigger picture of what we're doing for Portage County, and why that's important.
Absolutely. So what will happen is that in, homeowners receive their letters in May. We'll start doing samples in June. That's a good time of the year for us to collect these samples. So we're looking at the first couple of weeks in June of getting all of the initial sampling done.
Before summer break.
Exactly. There may be a possibility for some more intensive sampling, which wouldn't mean we would need to do an additional water sample. It would just mean that we'd be looking at possibly running some additional tests on the same sample, given time and finances and things like that. So additional sampling would take place a little bit later in June, in July analysis, because you know all these tests have to be analyzed. And then looking at data, there's a fair amount of data that we want to take a look at with this project surrounding land uses. What's the construction of the well if that information is available? How might that impact it? And the results that we're getting. So we anticipate results sometime around August or September for all of this. Homeowners that participate in the program will have their results mailed directly back to them. And there'll be some really nice informational materials that are included with that, including where their own sample ranks with the rest of the county. Because a lot of times people have the question, well, how does mine compare to everybody else's? And so that information will be available, and the information that's sent back to them is where they kind of fit in the whole scheme of things for the county. What we'd like to do is we'd like to take all of the data countywide then and make it available to the public in a couple of different presentations on the website so that people can understand and have access to it. But the importance of that is keeping the anonymity for the homeowners. We don't want anything linked directly back to them. So it's done at more of a rough scale of like the section or the quarter section so that a specific home can't be pinpointed when we look at where these samples are taken and the information is displayed.
I know I'm looking forward to those public sessions where we can talk with folks about the overall county picture and thank them for participating in helping us paint that picture with whatever the data shows us.
The success of this project really relies on the citizens of Portage County and their willingness to participate. They're the ones that are going to make this and the project that it is.
One of the things that I want to make sure that we talk about is that, you know, even if we weren't doing a study like this, we would want people to be thinking about getting their water tested if they're on their own private wells. And we usually say that we want people to get their water tested every 15 months so that we alternate, we move through the seasons, because like you said, water quality can be season specific.
Yeah, we see that in some cases that there can be a seasonable variation in water quality, especially nitrates. Nitrates tend to fluctuate quite a bit over time and throughout the year. And so we encourage people, you know, a lot of places will say do it at once a year, which is a great rule of thumb. It's easy to remember. We actually push for 15 months so that we can hit all of those seasons over time and kind of see, is there a pattern that's taking place? We really always want people to take a look at their water and their water quality and get it sampled. Just because, you know, for us, for those of us who live in the rural areas, we have to be our own water managers. We don't have somebody looking out for us. And it's always great to keep an eye on what's in my water, and especially if changes are taking place. Are things getting better? Are things getting worse? Are there changes that we notice? And we really want to be kind of clued into that for our own safety and our own health.
For everybody who is just joining us, my guest today on Portage County Matters is Jen McNelly, our water resource specialist here in Portage County. Jen's working as our point of contact in the county on a water quality study across the entire county that'll take place this year. As we look at those presentations later in the year, I think there's another element here I would like people to understand. You know, we've got these, how many samples did you say across the whole county?
269.
269 samples that we're seeking to obtain to cover the whole county and allow us to construct the picture of our water quality countywide for the first time in our history in one snapshot, in one moment in time.
At the same
scenario. Time. Yep. And then allow us to be able to replicate this in the future. But the other thing is that we have other ongoing water quality tests across the county which have data points that we'll also be able to integrate into painting this bigger picture, like those at bars or churches, restaurants, places like that, and as well as our municipal water systems.
Yeah.
So will you talk a little about that, Jen?
Absolutely. Up until this point in time when we're doing this program, one of the best sources of information that we've had are our drinking water sources called Transient Non-Community Drinking Water Sources. It's a long title, or TNCs, what we refer to them as. So they're places that serve the public, but the public passes through them. So think bars, churches, restaurants, those type of things that have their own wells. And so they're required by the state to have water quality sampling done usually once a year on a regular basis. And so they've, up until this point, provided us a great snapshot of a long-term trend of water quality. Our problem is that, you know, we have a handful of them. They're in certain areas in the county. They don't represent the whole thing. So at the same time that we're looking at this data, we also really want to take a closer look at that data as well and see what they're presenting us over the long term. And so we can look at both things side by side.
And also those municipal water systems.
Yeah, exactly.
They have to meet various standards and submit various reports, and then that goes into a database, and that can give us some great tracking systems as well.
Absolutely, additional information.
I remember when we were talking to prep for this show that you had reminded me that there wasn't a municipal system in Portage County that didn't have to tend to nitrate issues.
Yep, everyone in Portage County has had to address them in some way, shape, or form. So whether it be a new well, or taking wells offline, or treatment systems, it's kind of a widespread problem that we're dealing with.
All right, so as we take a look at this picture here, I think the timing is really lovely because we have a lot of citizen engagement in our groundwater management planning process in the county right now as it's in its final draft form. It's going up through committees on its way to the county board, we hope.
Yep.
And maybe you could talk a little bit about the relationship between this water quality test for the county and our groundwater management plan.
Sure. So our groundwater management plan, in that plan, the Citizens Advisory Committee, who was in charge of drafting that plan, really had three major concerns when they were talking groundwater in Portage County: groundwater quality, groundwater quantity, and then some communication information type concerns. So groundwater quality. One of the things that I get asked about the management plan was, why wasn't there a specific numerical goal in the plan? And that's a great question. Most plans would have one. But when the committee started to look at the data that was available and that we had, they just didn't feel like they had enough to make a really significant goal or an educated or informed goal that they felt was appropriate for the county. And so they chose to create an action that said, we really want to establish a monitoring program or a sampling program to delve into this issue and to take a look at it. And this program is the first step in answering that, in addressing that specific action. It sets up a program where over time that we can consistently monitor the water quality in Portage County through a sampling countywide at the same time. So this will be, it's a first step in a process, but it's a very important first step. GCAC is anxiously awaiting the outcome of this because they want to take a look at that information, and then they can set more specific actions or goals in place for things that they want to address. What's the best use of time and resources that are available to the county, and how can we get the biggest bang for our buck?
So our groundwater management plan, like I said, is in the final draft form. And this study allows us to check a box even just as we nearly complete the plan, which is very exciting, adopt the plan.
It is.
It's been years in the process, and certainly more than enough time has gone by for us to have our first baseline study like this. Talk about where we are in the committee process, and if citizens are still listening to us in April when the show airs in 2017, what can they do to get involved and stay involved in our water-related planning process in
the
county?
So right now, the plan is sitting with three county board committees. The Citizens Advisory Committee wrapped up their portion of the plan and sent it on its final way with recommendations to the
county. January, Jen?
I think so. In January was when they made their official recommendation of the plan. And so right now, it's sitting with the Planning and Zoning Committee, the Ag and Extension Education Committee, and the Land and Water Conservation Committee. And it looks like those three committees are going to be jointly discussing the groundwater management plan at the end of March and probably into April. The next step for those three committees will probably be to hold a public hearing on the groundwater management plan, which we're hoping will take place in April. So if people are listening, keep your eye out. That might be taking place, and you might be able to attend. It's a great place for the public to come and give feedback in support of, if you have concerns, if there's suggestions that you want addressed. That public hearing is an ideal spot to give that feedback. So that would be the next step for them. Once the public hearing is done, those three committees will decide on whether they want to recommend it to the full county board or not, and then it'll go to the county board for final adoption.
And then
afterwards,
I get to sign it.
And then you get to sign it.
Hey, so I just want all the listeners to understand that while you didn't talk a lot more about citizen input during that groundwater management planning process, there was a lot, and you did a marvelous job of helping all of the major points that were brought up in from all of these perspectives, that wherever that was in the process, get attention and have the Groundwater Citizen Advisory Committee, the GCAC, have a chance to take up all of those thoughts and decide what they wanted to do with them. So,
yeah.
I mean, great job and a lot of public input.
We had over 150 pieces of public input submitted to GCAC on the groundwater management plan, which is absolutely fantastic.
Sure.
I would say 99% of them were things that were changed, addressed in the plan to better reflect the concerns and suggestions that were brought forward to the committee. And so, if people are wondering, did the public get a chance to weigh in? Absolutely, they did. And it was so helpful to the process to be able to have that input.
I want to recognize Ed Burns, as I sit here, as one of the members of the Groundwater Citizen Advisory Committee. He's the chair of the GCAC, and he has been for, what is it now? It must be a decade.
It's been a while.
Very long time as a dad and a grower.
Yes.
And an amazing leader. And I have to say the whole process, because I was at many of those meetings, has been very, very respectful. And for those of you listening who participated in any of the groundwater listening sessions that we've conducted over the last couple of years, those inputs all made it into the plan in a broader sense and helped to provide a base of actions for the plan itself. So I have to tell you that I'm really pleased with the way that it's rolled out, with all of the efforts. I know that you have put a lot of time, Jeff Schuler, your supervisor, has put a lot of time into this, and so many citizens, including pockets of groups that have come to form their own ideas and then present them as a collaborative. That's been impressive. There's been growers in the conversation helping us understand the new technologies and all sorts of other things along the way that really get us to where we are. And now with this water quality study across the county, Jen, I think what you're going to help us do then is to create our next piece of history that others can learn from, just like they're learning from our groundwater management plan, because we have one that's very rare among counties. This will be another opportunity for us to teach other counties how to go about the business of caring for, stewarding their groundwater into the future.
Absolutely.
We have just a couple more seconds, and I would say to everybody out there, As Jen McNelly was talking to us here, our water resource specialist is talking to us about the groundwater quality study about to take place. Look for that letter to arrive in the mail for those of you who are lucky enough to receive one. It'll have a UW-Stevens Point logo on it, and you'll see Portage County teeming with UW-Stevens Point in the letter itself. Return your postcard. Please say yes to getting your water tested on this project. There's no cost to you additional to what the county's already put up with tax dollars, so that we can get this baseline going and you can protect the health and well-being of your family and the future of our county as well.
And if anybody wants any additional information or is curious how the project is progressing, there will be a website on the Portage County webpage where you can click on it, you can learn more about the project, the map of the selected wells will be posted, and we'll keep you up to date on what's happening and where in the process we are.
Perfect, Jen. Thanks everybody for joining us. We'll look forward to the results to the water study.